Hi, good morning everyone. Welcome to the session on CMA Part 1, Operational Efficiency. In today's session, we'll be discussing about various techniques that are used in improving the efficiency of the company so that you can produce the goods or provide services with a, highly competitive prices with no compromise in the quality. So we'll be discussing here different types of techniques that will help us to perform all the activities, produce the goods faster and effectively. Today's session concentrates on some more techniques which will help us to get the benefit of all the efficiencies which we use in our business process. One of them is value chain analysis. As we discussed in a life cycle costing of a product, we had three stages of costs. Means costs which are incurred before producing the goods, which we call them as upstream costs. Then manufacturing costs during the life of the product, what cost we incur here, manufacturing costs. And after sales, like downstream costs, like marketing, after sales service, like guarantee, warranty, etc. So in this life cycle, what are the costs involved from the inception to a product's exit from the market? We need to show efficiency in all the activities before we producing the goods, while producing the goods, after selling the goods. This is what we call it as value chain analysis. That you study all the activities that go into the production of the product and that add value to the finished goods. So adding value means here it is nothing but value added cost. Value added cost means any activity which you perform will either improve the performance of the product or quality of the product. So any cost, any dollar amount you spend, any additional activity which incurs dollar amount should improve the performance or the quality of the product. Yes, now the customer is ready to pay for this. Such an activity is called as value added activity. And the cost incurred on that can be recovered from the customer. So here, in the activities like R&D, designing of products and services, manufacturing cost, then marketing, selling and distribution, guarantees, warranties. So we need to see these activities. What are value added? What are non-value added? So by analyzing this, we'll come to know these are the value added. Yes, go ahead. These are the non-value added. Okay, let's not spend on it. So any activities that are not adding value can also be eliminated while studying deeply the cost involved during the life of a product. So value chain analysis help us to identify all the activities of a product from its inception to its exit from the market. Inception means before you start producing the goods, that is R&D, etc., until the goods which exit from the market. Say, for example, one particular model of a desktop computer, a laptop. Okay, so it begins with R&D. And ends with a guarantee warranty. So in between you have designing, manufacturing, marketing, etc. So all these activities need to be analyzed to search for what? Two things. One is whether it is value added. Yes, go ahead. Non-value added, try to eliminate it. Value added, customer is ready to pay for that. So you can spend. Non-value added, customer doesn't like to pay for that, so try to eliminate or reduce. that will this amount will reduce our profit. Why? Because the customer is not going to pay for that. So we need to identify the functions, the types, the for in the you know value chain, and the analyze the structural connections in this and analyze the dynamics which we use in value chain analysis to find out what are all value added activities and what are non value added activities. So in value chain analysis, as we discussed, that we have three types of expenses here: upstream cost before producing the goods, what we spend are called as upstream costs. These are the manufacturing costs, and these are all called as downstream costs. So let's say, for example, customer service. Okay, customer service activities will be analyzed, that whether we should have a customer service in-house or we will outsource it to provide service to the customers effectively. Or we may see the distribution of the goods, whether we should outsource it. Okay, say for example, Amazon.com. Amazon.com will see that whether we can give entire distribution service to an eminent company which has all the activities, okay, in a supply chain. So the moment a customer product and the supply chain is going to be handled by another company, which is effectively done. Otherwise, Amazon will have to have its own transportation department, supply chain, etc. So it is impossible. So this will be outsourced here. So we can identify and take action to improve the costs. So you can see in a value chain analysis, there are two types of activities: primary activities and support activities. Primary activities are involved in the core activities of the product or business, and support activities are the health department to the primary activities. Like, here we have inbound logistics, operations, outbound logistics, marketing and sales. These are the core activities. But to run these activities, we need some support activities as well, like accounting department, procurement department, IT, infrastructure, HR, etc. Process analysis. It is nothing but the analysis of complete the activities carried out in a particular a production process, in a particular service process. So it convey to the reader how the changes take place through the series of stages. This is a process analysis. So we can identify that whether this process is effective or ineffective. If it is ineffective, what we can do is we can find out that how effectively this can be managed. So what you need to do is you need to see that these and all to be effectively carried out. Say for example, in a manufacturing unit, a product passes from here you will have cutting department, here you will have assembling department, packing department, moving, and this is a storing department. So in this process, we need to analyze that where the costs are unnecessarily incurred in this area, how best we can avoid that, how best we can control that. This and all we can see once you analyze the processes. These processes can be classified into a continuous process, where the production is continuously put into action. So there is no end for this. Say for example, fast moving goods like food items and all, they go on, the process continually goes on. Batch, a production goes in a batches. Hybrid is nothing but the combination of both, continuous in batches. Hybrid is nothing but a process which continually managed in batches. So it's a combination of both. make to stock, you make the goods to stock them, and make to order, you make the goods based on the orders received. These are the different types of processes we have in a manufacturing industry. In process value analysis, we should see that the operational expenses, whether they are necessary or not. So the operations are to be identified, analyzed. These are the different operations to carry out the business. These operations are to be analyzed properly, the activities as well as the expenses in this area. And we should see that, is there any chance to operate more effectively by the same amount, or we can save any amount. Okay, so here, whether the particular activity customer is willing to pay for that, or even without that activity we can sell the product. Okay, so we should see from the customer point of view also, whether it is wanted by the customer. For that we are providing a service, or just we are providing the service asking that customer to pay. So that need to be also analyzed. So overall, by identifying these processes, what we achieve is we eliminate the unnecessary expenses, which will simply increase the cost of the goods and services. Without sacrificing the customer satisfaction, we should eliminate that too. No quality compromise, no supply chain compromise, etc. So customer should not sacrifice for that, because customer has lots of other, you know, products. We have lots of competitors, so substitutes. Yeah. Activity-based management is a concept where you can identify and evaluate the activities. Like we discussed in a process analysis, each and every activity we can identify that whether it is it worth to carry out, or it can be improved efficiently. So based on that, you can spend money on that. So these activity-based management are of two types: strategic and operational activity-based management. Operational activity-based management concentrates on in the short term that what how we can improve the operations, whereas strategic management is a long-term process. So the next important thing is that as we learn from our mistakes, as we learn from our experience, therefore we expect always a continuous improvement in the business operation. We should strive for the continuous improvement, which we call it as Kaizen. The process and value analysis, we should see that our employees learn by, you know, repeating the activities again and again. Say for example, we have 100 workers who produce 10,000 units in a month with 5% defectives. So this analysis, 100 workers, 10,000 units of output in a month period with 5% defective. So we have a 95% accuracy levels. So same 100 workers, after say 6 months of 1 year of, you know, doing the same process again and again, they may produce 10,500 units in a month time, and the accuracy levels, levels now, say for example, improved to 96%. So the defective percent is reduced to 4%. This is called an improvement. Same workers, same number of hours, labor hours, are able to produce more units because they are learning that continually doing any activity, if you save some time or within the time you produce more, it is called learning curve. Same workers, after their good satisfaction towards the business organization, say for example, same workers, after 2 years we observed it again that they were able to produce 11,200 units in a month time with 3.8% defective percentage. See, this is called learning process. See, number of hours did not change. There is no change in number of workers, number of hours, the time period, but the output improved and defectives decreased. Means the workers continually improving. So the process continually repeated, so there will be an improvement. If they are producing same 10,000 units in a month time by spending 8 hours with the same defective percent of 5%, means that there is no improvement. There is no learning. Okay, and this continuous improvement is termed as Kaizen. So we expect Kaizen in all the companies, because human beings learn from, you know, repeating the activities again and again. Therefore, we expect some continuous improvement in the human resources. So by continually repeating or performing the activities, we make things better. Yeah. So Kaizen is nothing but improving the activities from time to time by learning. Now we understand that Kaizen is required very much in every organization, especially manufacturing organization, so that the operations can be improved and the cost can be controlled. The next important concept in operational efficiency is supply chain. That how effectively we carry out the activities by rendering services or delivering the products to customer on time. So we need to have efficient calculations here and activities, okay, to supply the goods faster to the customer. Say customer is in need, is expecting the product is going to be delivered in 10 days. You are able to give delivery in 9 days. Yes, we are having effective supply chain management. Raw material to supplier, to manufacturer, to distribution, to customer. Yeah, these activities are to be carried out effectively. What is supply chain? Supply chain is nothing but the activities, okay, of an organization, people, the information, and the other resources what we have in moving the product or service from supplier to customer. So let me take you from here. Customer, we have a supplier, we have a customer. How effectively we perform these activities to move the product or service into the hands of the customer? How effectively? Okay, so this is called, you know, the supply chain management. In simple, the transformation of raw materials and components into finished products that are delivered to the end customer. So all these activities should be effectively managed. Any activity is not effectively carried out will have an impact on the rest of the things. Say for example here, factory. From there it goes to warehouse, then distribution, then the customer. Customer is waiting for the product, whether it is on time, it's available or not. So the activities are to be effectively carried out here to make our customer happy. Else what happens? He will be simply waiting for our product, which annoys him, or he may shift to the other product. So we should not let him wait for the product or let him spend money on, you know, waiting again and again. So we need to study deeply about the activities, you know, involved in moving the goods from supplier to customer. So supply chain management is the design and management of the processes which involved in moving the goods from supplier to customer. The organizational boundaries in in-house boundaries and the external. Then the goal of the matching supply and demand, so we need to understand the demand and supply according to that, and this has to be performed in an effective way. So the design and manufacturing of processes across the organizational boundaries with the goal of matching supply and demand in the most effective way is a supply chain management. How difficult the supply chain? So you need to study the uncertainty in demand or supply. Okay, change in the customer's requirements will also have an impact on supply and demand or supply chain. Decrease in the product life cycle, fragmentation of supply chain ownership. Okay, and conflicting objectives. There may be conflicting objectives in a supply chain management which need to be studied and identified. Okay, and they are to be improved. And conflicting objectives can be like fast goods movement here in the inventory, fast delivery, package types, etc. Production wants can be bigger batch size, okay, depot at factory, so that the goods can be shifted to depots from factory to depot. Shipping dates, decrease in changeovers. These are all the different objectives which have conflicts. So that you need to study and identify and effectively manage it. The next effective concept is business process reengineering. What exactly the business process reengineering is? It is nothing but use of the advanced technology or innovation in our business operations to carry out most of the activities effectively. Say for example, in those days we used to have typewriters to document any information. See, what are the disadvantages we have in a typewriter? We cannot store the data electronically. We can't maintain the what we call authorization, and we cannot transmit this information electronically. So lots of disadvantages. Can you think of a typewriter in an office today? No. Why? Because innovative products are launched. We have laptops, we have desktops. So the same activity can be carried out effectively by using another, instrument. So using this instrument, you can store the data, you can send the data electronically, you can maintain, confidentiality. You can store lots of data, and you have lots of flexibility. This is called business process reengineering, which means discard the outdated technology and use the innovative products and innovative products and technology to carry out the operations efficiently. Like many companies always strive for the innovation. Say we used to have a product which only prints, it doesn't scan. So for scanning again, we need to use another equipment called scanner. For taking photocopy, we have to use another instrument called photocopier. See, printer, fax machine, scanner and photocopier. See, different instruments are fixed in the office in different places. First of all, space, electricity and human resources to move from this product to this product, this product to this product. We have an equipment called all-in-one. We can print, scan, fax, take photocopy. Yeah, this is called business process reengineering. ATM machines, business process reengineering. Okay, the online transfers, business process reengineering. The delivery of the information through email, business process reengineering. Lots of techniques which we use in the business organization, due to the advanced technology. where the normal activities can be carried out effectively and with a cost control. Say for example, we want to see that how many customers visited our office, and we want to also see the customer feedback. So there will be a feedback machine at the counter, cash counter. So that shows that how many customers visited, also how do they feel about our products or services. Earlier we used to have a feedback sheets. So if the customer likes to, he will say, he will fill in this document. So most of the customers ignore this. It's a time consuming process. They have to literally write here or tick that this product is satisfactory or not. Yes, 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 like that. The moment here, the new technology, the cashier bills and customer hands over the cash to the teller, immediately same time before the bill is closed, the customer will press a button here, excellent, good, bad. So the bill and the customer feedback have gone into the system at the same time. Otherwise it's a manual process here. Okay, staff attendance. I'll give you some more examples. Business process reengineering. In business process reengineering, always we strive for the technology innovative products which will help us to carry out the activities very effectively with a cost control, with a great cost control. Therefore the operations that have become obsolete are to be discarded by adding a new technology. Some business commercial complex, you can see the escalators. Now escalators in the afternoon, lunch time, etc., automatically they switch off. The moment a person goes here at the starting point, the sensor will recognize that there is a customer, there is a person, okay, want this service. Automatically the escalator will begin. In most of the complexes we have automatic lights, like the moment you pass on, the lights will be on, lights on, then this will go off when the person moves this place. Yeah, so it is also a business process reengineering. And effectively in most of the the cab service companies, the cab service companies, they're using very effectively the BPR, the operator. Customer calls the operator, okay, for booking. It goes to the server, will understand that which cab, which area it is free, which car is available, and the message will go to the customer that this car is booked. So the driver, the registration number, the time, in how many minutes it can reach the customer's home, entire thing can be sent to the customer. So the customer can monitor that where the cab is, cab driver's number, how the cab is moving. So it reduces lots of cost and the outdated technology, like he has to call the cab driver that where are you, customer is waiting for you, then he has to call back the customer saying that sir, car is near, it is just 2 kilometers away from your home. Yeah, why? When customer knows that in his mobile or in his tab, he knows that the car is already booked, this is the cab driver number, and cab is moving towards his home. He can monitor this. He no need to call the call center again, it reached. Yeah. So many businesses are now striving for using the advanced technology to improve the services efficiently by controlling the costs. Yeah, so now we understand what is business process reengineering. Let us learn some more techniques, that is value engineering. Value engineering is a systematic and organized approach in an organization to provide the necessary functions but at the lowest cost possible. Okay, so all the function, necessary functions that are to be provided at the lowest cost. So it promotes a substitution of material, like we have X material, Y material. So without compromising the quality, whether we can use this material less expensive alternatives, but without sacrificing any functionality. That is very important. So without knowing about the quality of this product, say for example we used to use X, but we can also use Y instead of X without sacrificing the functionality or quality, we can go for less expensive alternatives. That is called value engineering. It can be labor, it can be material, etc. Okay, it is also known as value analysis. In fact, we are just seeing for substitutes where the cost can be controlled with no compromise in the quality. That's important. We are giving importance for the cost control, but doesn't mean that we are compromising with the quality. That's the reason why value engineering is not a cost reduction. You should always remember, it is only a design review. It is not a design review. No, the change in the design. It is not a risk elimination. It is not a quality reduction. It is not redesigning. It is not at all a detailed cost estimation. You should see only alternatives with no compromise in all this. So value engineering is looking at the alternatives, substitutes, which are highly cost effective. Benchmarking. The next concept is benchmarking. Benchmarking is the adopting the best practices that are followed by highly successful industries. Like a bank can benchmark a successful bank, like what is their lending policy, what is their operational policy, what is their compliance policy. We can adopt the best practices adopted by a successful bank. Like a student can benchmark with a successful student, means how he is to study, how he is to prepare, okay, how he is to clear his doubts, etc. Benchmarking is nothing but adopting the best practices of successful industries. So here we need to benchmark the successful operations of the other organizations by learning from their success factors. We can implement in our organization. So the advantage is that we no need to do experiments again. Somebody's experiment has become experience. We can use that experience and put into action without spending extra time and money. And one important point is that to benchmark someone, this someone need not be a competitor or in the same line of industry. If the company is in the same line of industry, you can even benchmark well, but like customer service or liquidity analysis, okay, like a company policy, compliance policy, this and all can be same for even or different line of business. But if the business is in the same line, like hotel industry to hotel industry, we can align lots of activities, compare and follow, adapt better. Activity-based management, as we discussed, are of two types, operational ABM and strategic ABM. Operational AGM is short-term concept, whereas strategic ABM is long-term concept. Operational ABM sees how best we can produce the goods or render services effectively, timely, and with a good cost control. But a strategic ABM, thinks in a long-term manner, that how best we can expand our operations by controlling the cost, how best we can improve our market share, etc. The next concept is outsourcing. Like we are into our core activities, like we are producing the goods here, we have men and machinery, the activities are going on, production department, purchase department, HR department, supervision department, maintenance department, accounting department, etc., or helping the production department. Then one day we identify that whether this maintenance department, which has four workers, one manager, okay, are rendering the services daily 2 hours, because they cannot work for 8 hours on maintenance, right? Okay, so the five workers, we assigned an office and they are, you know, spending their time 2 hours on this machine. Now we understand that five workers monthly wages in office, okay, instead of this, can we hire the services from outside professionally managed companies or not? So that these are all, these people are experts provided by another company for a monthly charge. So these people are not our employees, but provide services at our premises with a commitment as per agreement. So there will be a fixed amount will be paid to the company which is providing these resources. You don't need to worry about these five employees, because they might have 50 employees. Even if one falls sick, they will replace the other guy. So these 2 hour services only they will charge you, no monthly wages and all, etc. So daily 2 hours, 25 days a day, we'll have to pay 50 hours. Like security, we need a security, five security people. So five security people monthly, say for example, we are paying $3,500 directly to the security company. So they will arrange this five security people at your factory on regular basis. You don't need to worry about their sick leaves, annual leaves, etc., etc. At any time, always you will have five security people in your factory with a fixed amount of $3,500 per month. And you don't need to train them. You don't need to take care of them. You don't need to worry about them. On entire services are provided by the security company. This is called outsourcing. Like accounting, reconciliations, HR. These days, many subsidiary, the secondary activities are, you know, outsourced. Even courier is in outsourcing. Okay, maintenance, website management. These are all, you know, outsourced services. So that what we can do is we can concentrate on our core activities. That what is our business? This is our business. Let us concentrate on this. Like a banking industry, no need to concentrate on security. The security is provided by eminent security companies. The banking industry is no need to worry about the cash management. Like entire cash management is taken by some companies like G4S, TransGuard, etc. So what they do is they lift the cash from the bank and insert, replenish in the ATM centers. Okay, they send it to the central bank. All these activities are carried out by the outside companies. Okay, this is called outsourcing. It is nothing but practice of handing over the control of public services for profit operations. So we get most of the services rendered by others for a fixed payment. Like insurance, they may get some janitorial services, landscaping from the outside. Why insurance company should have a landscaping guys employed by insurance company? No need, right? No need. So these services can be hired from outside. Okay, so the firms outsource services because of one reason, that the firm can concentrate on its core business. An insurance company can concentrate on insurance. Why should we worry about security? Why should we worry about, you know, landscaping? Okay, and not only that, it reduces the cost. So landscaping, you need to hire again 5 people or 10 people who are engaged in this, who knows that how to maintain and all. So once you have this contract with the landscaping company, and you can mention in the contract that what are all the activities to be carried out and what is the amount. Monthly, there will be some fixed payment. And also, of course, access to new technology. Those people will use their own technology. We don't need to worry about technology. A reliable service. And also, we can avoid the risk of obsolescence. These are the examples of outsourcing. Most of the organizations, adopt. The reasons for outsourcing include we can focus on our, core activities. We can focus on our core capabilities. It transforms the organization. Like these days, customer care, customer service are all outsourced, and it increases the flexibility. And the operational reasons that it improves the performance, quality, etc., because they're all into professionally managed companies and expert skills, technology, even risk management issues. But there are some problems with outsourcing, that we lose control of our own business. There will be a definite cash outflow every month. Sometimes confidentiality is a big issue. Selection of a supplier who provide the services is also a very important point. It is too dependent on the supplier or provider. Okay, loss of staff, we lose our staff. Moral problems will arise in the company when you start outsourcing each and every activity. It's a time consuming process. And the service provider may not understand our business environment by providing the services, or he may act very slowly according to our requirements. There are some advantages and disadvantages I mentioned here. So please take care of this from the examination point of view in essay. Advantages include we can focus on our core activities, but it is costly. The activities can be carried out because the service provider is a professionally managed company. Loss is that we will lose the control of our business. We have access to the new technology. Here, we lose quality control because we are depending upon these third-party services. It reduces the expenses. Why? Because we have only a fixed payment. And if you maintain the same thing in-house, it will cost us more. May result in less personalized service because it is provided by third party. Improves the quality and timeliness, but it depends upon the supplier. These are the topics which we need to concentrate on: operational efficiency. Hope you understand, and we'll see some more techniques in the coming topics, coming sessions. Thank you, and have a great day.